Okay. Anyway, thanks for coming. I'm Rick. I'm W5RH. I need to take a survey. How many KE, KF, and KG calls are in the room? Okay, you guys and ladies are all fairly new, so that's good. There's a lot of older hams in this room. I'm one of them. We got Ross and John and John and Ron and Mike. We all remember when we were 15 and 16 and we didn't know anything, but we were hams. We passed that test, we passed the code, but we didn't know anything. We were excited, we were curious, and that's where you are now. So I've taken that, the feeling that I had when I was 16, I remember building my first antenna, and I put it into a presentation, the things that I've learned over the years that I really needed to know. Now, you gotta realize that if we were gonna give you the complete story, we'd be here 3 days. Antennas are, it's not definite, it's magic. You all know what FM stands for, don't you?
Friendly magic.
Yeah, friendly magic, yes, okay. That's what RF is. Anyway, so you're a new ham, you might know a little bit about RF. You're excited and curious, you know, you want to get on the repeater, so you buy an HT and you listen to the stuff on there, and then you hear all this talk about HF, so you ease yourself in and you go, you finally figure out that you really need to buy that Eleflex Yacom Wood radio. And you need a power supply and you got that and you're all set, except I need an antenna. And you hear all of these horror stories about antennas. So you go buy a lot and you put up an antenna and then you build a house. Come on. And then when you say to your wife, I'm going to put up an antenna, or your spouse, I'm going to put up an antenna, let me go back. Your spouse or significant other thinks this. Come on. Why is it not? All day it's working and now it's not working. Okay, so this is what we're going to talk about tonight, the antenna system. The antenna, which we call the load, the transmission line, which is the coax, the feed line, or whatever, and your transceiver, that's the source. Okay, so your steps to the success of antennas is, for one, you have to expand your knowledge. You gotta start to understand the system. You gotta understand why antennas work, why feed lines work the way they do, things like that. And I'm not talking about going and taking college physics again to understand all the equations and so forth, but you just gotta understand how things work. And when you're building antennas, you've got certain skills that are required. You need to be an electrician, you need to be a physicist, you need to know geometry and trig, you gotta have mechanical skills and even chemical skills, because you're gonna be sealing and working with things and so forth. But the number one skill you gotta have is people skills. You gotta find yourself an Elmer. If you don't know what an Elmer is, that is an experienced ham who can help you through this jungle of antennas and feed lines. There's a lot of Elmers in this room. Tom W5TOM's one, I'm one, Ron's one, Ross HFF is one, IZO, Pete QPX is one, Eddie's one. People that have been around for a long time. Find yourself a good Elmer. They may not know all the answers, but you know what? They'll know where to find them. So, let's talk about antennas per se. Trying to keep a lot of away from a lot of theory and get hands-on, that's what all this stuff is gonna get into. But we gotta have a number. Where do you start? 468, that's the magic number for an antenna. 468 divided by the frequency you're going to use it on in megahertz gives you a half a wavelength in feet. What's the magic of a half a wavelength? A half a wavelength is the shortest piece of wire that is resonant that will work. You can work with shorter. There's ways to do that, but let's start with a half wave dipole and go from there. The dipole's a half wavelength long. Again, 468 divided by the frequency, so let's pick a band. If you go 80 meters, you're gonna go to 3.910, which is the RAG-CHU net frequency, Wednesday night, 8 o'clock, K5LKJ, little commercial there, join us. Or you get on 10 meters, which is the shot group on Tuesday night, 8 o'clock, 28,488. The 80 meter antenna is 119 feet long. The 10 meter antenna is 16 feet long.
Much easier.
Okay, but in 1925, hams had the same problem that we have today. They may not have the John Stratton problems, but they had other problems. And Murphy came up with this, and he said the average transmitting amateur has simply got to fit the antenna into the space available. If you have a small backyard, it's got to fit. You have a large backyard, it's going to fit. It's going to be easier. But you do what you can to put that antenna in that space. So the 10-meter dipole is 16.4 feet long. You're going to need some parts. And you're kind of at this point going, hey, great, a dipole. What the heck is that? This. That's everything you need. It's not 16 feet long. But it's got an insulator on the end, an insulator on the end. It's got a center insulator. It's got coax coming up from your transceiver that's connected to the antenna. That's the dipole. That's the simplest thing. That's Larry, K5LJ, wrote an article, and it's on the BVARC tech articles page, and you need to reference a lot of this stuff. The 80% solution, I think you called it. And it was about, you know, when you put up a dipole, you're very close. You get more elements with a Yagi or something like that, you'll get more gain. But this is it. This is the magic key. This is the center, the driven element. This is what you really need to do. So if you've never seen a dipole, this is a dipole. It's typically put up like this. And somebody's calling me. Fine. Yes, the dogs and cats have been fed. Sorry. She works late, so sorry. Anyway, I'm glad it wasn't something else. So the next step is, okay, you want to build one of these things. Where do you buy this stuff?
Okay.
EPO is a good suggestion. That's an in-town stuff. An in-town place to go, EPO on Fondren, and there's one down in Clear Lake maybe, I don't know. eBay is on town. You've got insulators, you've got aluminum wire, you've got all types of antenna wire. These are wire nuts. That's one way to do it. You can also solder it. This is just rope that you can buy online. Your coax can be bought online. DX Engineering has all this stuff. There's lots of places to... Yeah, tarred trot line. Yeah,
I do. The Alfred should supply all that,
shouldn't if you come to my garage, yes. But if you go to other Elmer's garages, probably not. But yeah. So anyway, that's and this stuff isn't expensive. It's wire and insulators and so forth, and you can put it together.
Or you can buy them pre-made,
but don't talk to me if you do. That's why I have all this stuff, because I like to build my own stuff. There's nothing wrong with buying it, but you pay $80 for a dipole and you can do it for $15. So anyway, you got to, so like I said, one of the ways you can deploy it is, you know, horizontal like this. You can also turn it this way vertically. It's kind of hard because the feed line hangs down and there's reasons for not doing that. You can slope it like this. You can hang it up as an inverted V, where you put this up in a tree and put these out to the side. That's an inverted V. They give you all different patterns. So, you know, it's really what you can do, you know, what you can do in your backyard with that antenna. And for DX, you really want to get it about a half wavelength high if possible, because then your angle of radiation is lower, and that'll come a little bit more clear. You want to keep it away from man-made objects. You don't want to run it, if you can, you don't want to run it under the eaves of your house or down the side of your house, right next to the brick and so forth. Get it out away as much as possible. So there's one big question, because people will read things and they say, oh, it says in the book that I need to have a piece of coax that's three wavelengths long, or, you know, for this special antenna. Wrong. How long should your coax be? As long as it gets from the antenna to the radio, so you can get the power to the antenna. It can be 20 feet, it can be 200 feet. You know, there's different situations. You use the best coax you can get in the situation you have. but it's just long enough to get from this connection to the back of your radio. Okay, one of the nasty things about transmission lines and building a dipole is this little thing right here. It's called a PL259. It goes on the end of the coax at your radio. I'm sure you've bought coax and you stick it in and you turn it on. Your 2 meter has one. Everybody has one of these PL259s. They're kind of difficult to put on, but Tom, W5TOM, has put together a video, and hopefully I've got service and we can play it.
This is the best way to put a PL259 connector on RG8X or RG58 coax using the adapter ferrules. The UHF connector PL259 has been around for a long time and was originally designed for RG8 coax. For use on the smaller sizes, RG8X and RG58, a ferrule is provided. The prescribed method of securing the shield to the connector is to solder through the holes provided on the sides. Frankly, this is a poor way. This also leaves the cable free to wiggle and twist, which soon results in breaking the small hard-drawn wires and then failure. This method also has poor tensile strength. If attached to the feed point of a dipole and has to support the weight of the coax, it will soon fail. Bad connectors cause most of the problems in the ham shack and are the hardest to find. My method solves these problems. Since the ferrule does not reach the dielectric block that holds the center conductor tube, it cannot capture the shield wires and stabilize them from movement. This space must be filled. After assembly, if the coax can be twisted or wiggled, it will fail. Start by stripping the covering 7/8 of an inch from the end and place the ferrule over the coax and fold the shield wires back over the ferrule. Place the coax and ferrule in a small desk vise facing up. Carefully solder around the top edge of the ferrule on the wire until all the wires are soldered together and the height of the edge has been built up about 30 to 50 thousandths of an inch. Then trim the excess wire so it is clear of the threads. If solder has built up on the sides excessively so it makes insertion into the connector difficult, just squash it down around the sides with your pliers or trim off the excess with a pair of dykes. Strip the dielectric from the center conductor, leaving 1/8 of an inch above the solder band. After insertion and making sure all the center conductor wires are in the tube, then tighten the ferrule all the way. Next, check to see if it can be wiggled or twisted. It should be tight and stable. Check with a VOM for continuity and then solder the center conductor. Don't forget to put the connector band facing the right direction on the coax before you start. Your connector will be stable and tight for years to come, no matter whether it's connecting your rig to the amp or the amp to your dipole. For more technical ham information, please visit my website, W5TOM.com.
And that is an excellent point. Visit W5TOM.com. He's got other videos and things like that. It's great stuff. So let me get out of here. That's the last time I use that. Okay, I'll bring up, I used Tom's video as a reference. He's got other videos. But on the sheet I gave you, there's a lot of references on there. They'll be also in the presentation. But because this is such a, it's not a difficult topic, it's just a lot of intertangled things happening all at the same time. You're gonna have to do a little bit of research on your own and reading and so forth. There's lots of things online and books and things, and that's what's referenced in that handout. So another gotcha on a dipole is, should I use a balun? You know, you've got an antenna up there, and typically you'll use something like either feed it directly like that, or you use a balun like this, one-to-one. It just goes an unbalanced connection, which is coax, to a balanced connection, which is the antenna. There's all different types that you can build, you can make. Here's another one that's a 4-to-1. Let me go to the tangled up here. Did it again, sorry. Okay. Now, why are you going to use a balun at the feed point? First off, it's a balun. It's balanced to unbalanced. That's not a balun. So it's pronounced balanced, unbalanced, balun. Typically, they're 1-to-1 ratio, impedance ratio, 50 ohms to 50 ohms, or 4-to-1, 50 ohms to like 200 ohms. Those are easy to build, or easy to buy, depending. And why do you need one? Well, what you're trying to do is, on a piece of coax, which this diagram is, it's got three surfaces. And the reason it has three surfaces is something called skin effect. RF doesn't travel on the thickness, the full thickness of the wire, the shield. The outside of the shield and the inside of the shield of the coax are two separate surfaces. So you have your currents going up the center and inside the shield, but then when it gets up to the top, that one that's on the shield splits. It goes out into the element and also comes back down the shield. You don't want that current on the shield because it messes up your pattern, especially on something like a Yagi. You want all the stuff going in that direction, the way the Yagi's pointed. On a dipole, even Joe Reisert from Cushcraft said, look, don't use the balun. It's okay to have currents on the coax because it may radiate into, you know, it may vertical polarization into some part of the world that you're not going to get with the dipole. But that's the reason you're going to use a balun, to keep that the antenna currents off of there. One other way you'll get antenna currents on the outside shield is from the antenna itself. The recommended deployment of a horizontal dipole is to have the dipole up here and the coax run straight down all the way to the ground. That's perpendicular to the antenna. But if you had your coax sort of hanging like that, it couples to the outside shield as the antenna radiates, so you'll get antenna currents on the shield. And then the antenna's currents will be on the shield and they'll go into the shack and cause all types of problems with RF and noise and things like that. And there's ways to get rid of that, but we'll get to that in a minute. So let's just do a little bit of maybe some theory here. Standing wave antennas. These are standing wave antennas, typically like a dipole. It's a standing wave because if I just take one side, if the charge comes up, the charge travels to the end and back. Does the same thing on this side. And when it gets to the end, it's got nowhere else to go because it has to flow within a wire. It flows back. Well, it just goes back and forth like that. And it sets up a, quote, standing wave. I've got some diagrams in here. As opposed to a traveling wave antenna. Now, a traveling wave antenna is an antenna that has some type of humongous length, or it's got a termination, a resistor at the end. So the charge goes down to the end and it gets burned up in the resistor, the stuff that is not radiated. But we're not talking about traveling wave antennas here, we're just talking about standing wave. These have a resonant length, 468 divided by the frequency. They have a feed impedance that we'll look at. Again, standing waves, they got a certain current distribution, and they're polarized, horizontal, vertical, depending on the way you shape them. So what is resonance? Resonance is when there's no X sub C or X sub L, which is capacitive reactance or inductive reactance. So on a measured impedance, so like 50 ohms with J ohms, which is the reactance, you should know this from your theory, that's a resonant antenna. Now, you can't really get to zero. I mean, you'll get close to zero, but it'll be within the ballpark. And we don't operate on one frequency. We operate on bands of frequency, so something that's resonant here isn't going to be resonant 100 kc down. Okay, matched is another term that's thrown out there. What does matched mean? It means that when one device's impedance matches another device's impedance, just like 50 ohm coax matches the feed point of this antenna, which is 50 ohms. So that's a matched condition. It's not a required condition. That's just a definition of a match condition. And here it is. Here you'll see when the charges go back and forth and they get set up, it literally puts a sine wave of current, I, across the whole antenna. That's the standing wave. And the voltage also does the same thing. That's the standing wave. The current has a loop in the middle, so it's the high current point is in the middle, but for the voltage, the high current point is at the ends of this half wave standing wave antenna. Now, Ohm's law. What is the impedance of the antenna at this point? Well, it's high current, low voltage. Well, low voltage, high current, it's current fed. It means that it's going to be a low impedance here. When you get out here where the voltage is very high and the current's low, you're going to have a very high impedance. And the impedance varies as you move out. And there's different types of antennas that use these situations. If you feed it in the center, it could be 72 ohms, could be 50 ohms, things like depending on height above ground. You feed it at the end where it's got a high impedance, it's going to be 1K or higher. You feed it off-center, you've heard of off-center fed dipoles for using in multibanding. It's about 400 ohms. But again, as you slide that feed point out, you're going to change that. So that's an important thing to know, that you can change the feed point of the antenna, feed point impedance, to match your feed line. Okay, so you did all that, you built the dipole, you understand what's going on, you put it up, you put it in as high as possible in the clear, and you connect it up and you hear something, and you know 10 meters is kind of, you know, sometimes it's on, sometimes it's off, and you have no idea if you're getting out, you're calling CQ, your rig might have an SWR meter, but you go, well, SWR, what, why do I need SWR, what's that? So, you know, and I had that moment long many years ago. What is SWR? So let's talk about it. SWR, it's something that we use to adjust the antenna system. It's a measurement that we use. This fella used his SWR, and he cut 2 feet from either side, but his SWR went kind of high. So, I don't know. When you figure that out, let me know. Okay, so it's a measured value, and it measures the quality of the match between the feed line and the antenna, which is the load. It measures the match at this particular point, because SWR is always figured at the antenna. Now, you can measure it other places, but the reason it exists is what's happening right here at this point. And we have, nominally, we have 50 ohm coax. The transmitter output is nominally designed to feed into 50 ohms, and the antennas that we use are kind of 50 ohms. You know, I mean, they're marginal. There's exceptions to everything I'm saying tonight, but you know, let's stick with the 50-50-50 example. Okay, why do we have that? Because we want to get the 100 watts that comes out of our transceiver going into this coax. We want that 100 watts to be 100 watts here too at the antenna. So we get 100 watts worth of radiation out of this antenna. So we want maximum power transfer throughout the whole system. The way you get maximum power transfer is for have everything to be matched. 50 ohm output, 50 ohm coax, 50 ohm antenna. Everything's matched, so you get maximum out. And like I said, it's accomplished by having that matched system. Now, the transmission line, it's also called the feed line. It's a passive device. There's no active devices in here. And it's primarily used for getting from the transmitter to the antenna. So it plays a very important part in our ham radio station. So you want to pay particular attention to the quality, the makeup, how you put things together, and so forth. You don't want it to be shorted or anything. And there's different types. There's thin ones like this, RG58. There's RG213, which is a lot bigger. There's LMR, which is double shielded. You can see there's a double, there's a foil shield up here, and then this is the tin shield. You get twin lead like this. That's 450 ohm. You get twin lead like this. If you had TV antennas years ago, that's 300 ohm. All different types of feed line is available. All different types of coax for use at HF and VHF and UHF, you know, because the losses go up and so forth. But they all have different characteristics. George Grammer, who was the editor for the antenna book and everything in 1957, said this. If he had one wish in ham radio, he wished the antenna and the transmission line were lossless, because there's a lot of power that's lost in the transmission line and on the antenna, even though they're matched. So none of these really are made to consume power, but they do. You know, you put power into here and it's going to consume power. You know, it's going to be like a toaster. You know, the wire is going to heat up just because it's wire. There you go. So now this is all well and good, you know, but it's always nice to know what happens in an antenna. You know, you have this dipole up there, you have your coax, it comes into your transceiver, and we'll talk about SWR a little bit more, but what happens on that transmission line? So let's go through that. Now this transmission line on this is many, many, many times longer than a normal transmission line as far as wavelength, and you'll see here that I've got multiple cycles. You know, usually a piece of coax on 80 meters is maybe not even an eighth of a wavelength, but just for demonstration purposes, I've made the feed line very, very, very long. So you have your transmitter, you have your forward power coming to the antenna, and this is matched. So you got 50 ohms here, 50 ohms there, 50 ohms here. All of the power that gets to the antenna that put out by the transmitter is radiated. It's matched. Everything's cool. You have zero reflected power. Of course, we hadn't talked about reflected power yet, but that happens when it's not a matched system, when the coax is 50 ohms, but the antenna may be 80 ohms, 100 ohms, 120 ohms, something's causing it to be off resonance. What's going to happen is part of that forward power actually gets reflected back. How much is reflected back is dependent on the value of the mismatch. If it's a little mismatch, a little power. If it's a big mismatch, a lot of power. So what happens on the feed line is that you've got the transmitter putting out sine waves of 7.100 megahertz on 40 meters, and it meets the antenna, which is not matched, and that power gets put out of the antenna, but some of it gets put back towards the transmitter. So you have these two waves, one going this way, one going that way, and yes, Virginia, you can have two waves on a coax going two different directions at the same time. Same thing if you're familiar with fiber optics, same thing in that. So what happens is that these independent waves go past each other, and it sets up some standing waves online. And it actually sets up something like this. You can see the variation. You get small and large. Sometimes they add, sometimes they subtract. Sometimes they add, sometimes they subtract. And this sets up almost like a modulation pattern, but it produces these mins and maxes. And those mins and maxes, if you put them into an equation, create a standing wave ratio. So if you have a small amount of reflection, your standing wave ratio is small. If you have a large reflection, you have a large mismatch, your standing wave ratio is large. So you can use the standing wave ratio to indicate the quality of the match of your antenna and your coax. And we always do that. And this is all the reason behind why we measure standing waves, and I'll get to that in a minute. But I want to point out this. This standing wave and the waves, the forward and reflected waves, is something sometimes very difficult to understand. I know, because I didn't get it for a long time. On that piece of paper, I reference an AT&T video that's online. You watch that, it shows you, it demonstrates mechanically forward waves, reflected waves, standing waves. It matches. Everything is demonstrated in that video. It's so enlightening. I mean, I wish I would have saw that 40, 50 years ago when I was getting into ham radio. That's a really good one to watch. So I said before, but let's talk about the SWR again. It's always determined by the antenna itself. It's the antenna versus the coax, the transmission line. And the SWR, it doesn't change the length of the coax if the coax is lossless. If you had a piece of wire that didn't have any resistance in it, you'd have the same voltage at this end that you had at that end. So there'd be no loss there. However, in reality, that coax does have resistance. So you do have a differential. Your SWR, the difference in that match is greater here because this is where you've got maximum forward power and then your reflected power goes back. But your reflected power gets less and less and less and less back to the transmitter end because of the losses in the coax. So the SWR is greatest at the load. Okay, so now, all that theory behind us, sorry if it's confusing, but how do you measure SWR? Well, you measure it with an SWR meter, of course. I mean, how do you measure speed? You measure it with a speedometer. So let's look at an SWR meter. You can measure the power forward and reversed. You can use like a bird watt meter. I'll show some pictures here in a minute. There's a cross needle meter you can show, or you can use a vector network analyzer to measure it. We'll go through each of these. Over there is a bird watt meter. It's a standard within the industry. If it says it's 103 watts, it's 103 watts. It's NIST calibrated device, has been for years. But it measures forward power, and then you turn that gold thing there, the sensor, you turn it the other way and it measures reverse power. So all you have is power forward and power reverse. It's not giving you SWR directly, you need a chart. And I'll show you the chart in a minute. You can do the same thing with a meter like this. A lot of people have seen that where you put out, turn on your transmitter and you put it up to a certain point and then flip it. And then it shows you what the SWR is. It's actually measuring the coefficient of reflection, but let's not go there. You have these cross needle meters. You have one measuring forward power and this one measuring reverse power. And where they cross, there's a nomograph here of SWR. So that's a really easy way to see what the ratio is. And you can see the forward power going up and the reflected power as it goes up, the SWR numbers go up 1.2, 1.3, 1.5, 2, 3, 4. So the more reflected power, the higher the standing wave ratio number that's indicated. The best one, most accurate one, is one that's done with a VNA. This is a LP100A, a telepost. I have one, Alan has one, somebody else has one too, I think. But this is, it measures phase, voltage and phase and the current and everything and gives you a complete indication of what's happening on your transmission line. It's quite good. Going back to the bird watt meter where you've got forward and reflected power, you have to associate that with, you're putting out 100 watts, but you turn it and you get, say, 10 watts reflected, you have an SWR 1.92. Now, why is this important? Well, the higher the SWR, the more reflected power, the less power you're getting out of the antenna. But also, on the solid state rigs, you've got a problem with that because they don't like anything over like 1.5 SWR, and they'll start to reduce power. So you're trying to pump 100 watts out into a 2-to-1 SWR, and it's not going to put out 100 watts. It's going to cut down to 75 or 50 or even sometimes less than that. And there's the cross needle meter. You can also use, for measuring SWR, not when you're operating, but you can also use an antenna analyzer. This is MFJ-259. They're very, very, very popular. These show you SWR and frequency and the actual impedance numbers. There's no graphs or anything. There is a couple of meters, but this is the first iteration of measuring SWR. The newer ones, Rig Expert, Ron, this is Ron's K5HM. This actually, you hook it up to your line, you set the frequency, I guess, and hit the button, and it scans and it shows you a graph of your SWR. And it also shows you all the values too, right, Ron?
Yeah.
But it's you know, microprocessor controlled and everything. It's quite good. What do these cost?
I don't remember what it's called.
Three. You won one, didn't you? Yeah, 350. These, the 259s, I think are like 250, 260. You know, these are good. Now, Jerry just brought this one in. This is from Step IR. This is called the SARC. Not even the shark or the snark, but it's the SARC. This is the newest VNA-based antenna analyzer. You know, and it's also got, you know, the graph and everything. Jerry doesn't know how to use it either. Yet. Yeah, really. But I'm sure the book's thicker than the actual device. You know. So anyway, and what? How much was this, Jerry? How much was this?
$450.
Okay. So there you go. So you just keep pumping money into it, and you'll get really cool things like this. There you go. So. Yeah. Okay. Now the problem with these is that they do a great job, but they put out very, very small voltages. So what happens is that when you're using this and you have an AM radio station 8 miles that way, and it's coming across your antenna, it's really messing this up. And there was an article written by me. It's about blame it on ISO, and it's on the tech articles page, and it's all about us at John's house. He's out there, he's working on the paper, getting these weird indications. So I investigated it. Same thing at my house, because I'm west of him. There's the Spanish 850 radio station has a 5-element array, and the main lobe comes right across our houses. And you can actually see it on the meters on there. You just connect your antenna, turn all the oscillators off, and you can see the SWR bridge indicate.
How much forward power is
It's like 10,000 watts during the day. That's not affected radio power. That's transmitter power. And then at night, they cut it down to like 165. But still, affected power is, radiated power is quite hot.
I got 15,000.
Yeah, so. Anyway, so if you're interested in finding out what happened there and why that happens, that's a good article to get. There's the VNA base. This is an operational inline meter. This is really good. Well, the reason I bought this is Bob Stroff. He's with Clear Channel. Isn't Bob with Clear Channel? He's their chief engineer, and he said, "Oh, we use a operating impedance bridge." I said, "What the heck is that?" He said, "Oh, we can drive it with 100 watts. We can eliminate the interference." So I researched it, and this meter did it. So I can pump in 100 watts, 200 watts, 300 watts. Alan has one. He pumps a little bit under 5,000 into it.
Never over
5,000. See, that's the goal. But you can eliminate that. So when you're measuring SWR, you know. But these are things to keep in mind. The things that have been learned over the years.
You know,
about $400. And you can get single sensor and dual sensor, so you can have them in both things and so forth. Let's move on. This is one of the things that shows if your transmitter's down there and your antenna's here, and you say you're putting out 1 watt, that's the one, and your forward power gets to the antenna, well, because of the loss, it's down to 0.75 maybe. And then because the mismatch, you get your reflected power, which is about 3.5 or 0.35 watts. It gets reduced because it's got loss also. So both of these are lost, but if you measure at the antenna, that's your real ratio, the forward power to reflected power. But look at it down there. If you measure your SWR at the end of your coax at your rig, you've got maximum transmit power and minimum reflected power, and that gives you a very low SWR. So it's a false indication of what's really happening on the line. This is a little trick to know about and to measure. The longer the coax, the worse this situation is going to get. This also shows, or this graph shows, and I'm not really going to go into this, but it shows as your SWR increases, your losses in your whole system increase too. That's why they say, you know, if you put a tuner at the end of a piece of coax and tune it for a band that's like the second harmonic, you're going to have major losses, and it's just not going to be a good system. And that's part of the problem. But again, that's something for you to do later. Now, we use meters for measuring standing wave ratio, but to actually see what's happening on a transmission line, that's the thing about electronics. You can't see it. You can't see the charges. You have to measure things. But the nice thing is that these people have come up with these really great software programs. One of them is TL Details Dan McGuire. That's on the sheet. Another one is if you get the ARL Antenna Handbook, anything by Dean Straw is very good. But he's got a program called TLW, Transmission Line something. I don't know. But it's also very good. And they're pretty simple to use. This is transmission line details. And he has all of the coax capabilities put in. You just put in your frequency. You put in the load of the antenna or the load at this end of the coax. You put in the length and everything. And it shows you the losses in the SWR at different points. Here are the losses over here. Years ago, when there wasn't computers and all that, and when computers were a slide rule and a guy with a pencil and a paper sitting in a room called a computer, we did that on seismic crews, we used the Smith chart. The Smith chart was a special graph made to represent what happens on a transmission line. And this essentially, thank God, takes the place of dealing with the calculations and everything that you need to do with the Smith chart. But the way it works, you can actually see how things are influenced on the Smith chart. Now, that's 45 second definition of what transmission line details is, but what it does for you is phenomenal. You can see what your losses are in your feed line and so forth when you're designing these systems. So again, we didn't have those 30 or 40 years ago, so we just kind of hook things up and hope for the best. So there's other measurements you can do. One is, how do you measure resonance? Resonance, if you need a certain length of feed line, you need to figure out the quarter wave or half wave and so forth. A lot of people have built these. It's a grid dip oscillator, it's a Heath kit. There are different size probes, coils that actually go on here. And then you couple that coil to whatever you're trying to resonate. And then you tune in your frequency here and watch the meter dip, grid dip oscillator. When it dips, that's resonance. And depending on the size of the dip and so forth is the Q of the circuit. But this is older technology, but quite valid, even in today's world. Now, there are coils that you can get for the MFJ. I had some one time, and I didn't like it very well. I just used these as a grid dip oscillator. So for measuring resonance, another property of the antennas, grid dip oscillator. Impedance, you can measure impedance by that VNA. And I thought I had brought something, but I didn't. In between the old standing wave bridge meter and the modern stuff, there was something called a noise bridge. And what it was SWR bridge, but they injected it with wideband noise. And then you just caused the bridge to be balanced or unbalanced depending on the antenna impedance. Noise bridge, but it's a Wheatstone bridge, but it's driven by a wideband noise source. And then of course, for impedances, you can also use, the antenna analyzer. And, it's not just for measuring antennas. You can measure the impedance of coax. You can measure the impedance of a circuit. So, one of the things I would recommend is that when you do use things like this, make sure that they're working. In my box here, where I always keep this, I have precision resistors for 50 ohms, 100 ohms, 200 ohms. So if I'm out at somebody's house and I go to measure an antenna and things don't look right, I can get out one of those resistors and put it across here and go, okay, yeah, 50 ohms, okay, 200 ohms, okay, this is good. Something else is causing the problem. And the reason I do that is because of that blame it on IZO situation. So you can see so far, I mean, we're building up knowledge, we're building up devices, you know, and I'm not saying, you know, you'd need to go out and buy this stuff tomorrow, you know, but you need to do the basic things first and then buy something and learn a little bit more and learn how to use it and so forth. Like I said, it's not a destination, it's a journey. Okay, you hear about the antennas? They got married? Sorry, I know. Prairie Home Companion. Okay. Let me see what time it is. Oh, thank you. Well, I'm gonna have to hurry up here. Another thing about computers and antennas is that we now have that you can simulate antennas. You can model the antennas on a computer. I'm gonna run through this pretty quick here. You can go through a thing called EasyNeck. You can use the demo version that's on that paper. You'll get plots like this for a 3D plot, or you can get a plot from the top, a plan view plot. Shows you, like, this is a dipole, and it shows you the figure eight pattern that you read in the books about. And from the side, you can see if it's a certain height above ground, you can see that the main lobe is, you know, 30 degrees. So you can model your antenna that you have in your backyard. And it also can give you plots of the SWR. Now this is models now. This is not measurement of empirical, but what you try to do is you try to measure and see what the measurements are and then come in and generate a model. That way you can see what your antenna's doing in the computer. Sometimes you can get close, but I haven't gotten exact yet. But it's a good thing if you're sitting there on a rainy day and you feel like doing antenna work, Model something in the computer. Now, what you need to do beforehand is you need to know that EasyNeck operates on a XYZ system. You know, so you're defining the points of the antenna as an XYZ point, the next one is an XYZ point, and because it uses that to calculate everything. But it's something to really investigate, EasyNeck. I was going to demo it, but we're behind, so no. So, okay. So, people say, okay, I've got this antenna up there, but I want to do something different. I've gotten high SWR at one end of the band, so should I put a tuner? Where should I put the tuner? Things like that. So let's talk about that for a while. That's something that a newer novice, neophyte, new ham needs to know. Let's go through the history of antenna tuning units, ATUs. You had tube type equipment years ago, and at the end of that plate, the PA amplifier, you had a tank circuit. That tank circuit had adjustable coils and capacitors and so forth. So you really did match the whole system right there in the transmitter, no problem. Well, then we went to solid state, and the first solid states were 50 ohm output. And by golly, if you were 55 ohm or something like that, you know, those finals would blow. Very little variation could be had. So people would use an external manual type tuner. Well, like this, a Dentron. It's a manual tuner. It's got variable capacitors. It's got selectable coils and so forth. But that's what people use. This is probably a 600-700 watt tuner. 1,000 watt, okay. Okay, not for RTTY, but anyway. So that's what people used with that. But then later, in the solid state rigs, they started putting in tuners inside the units themselves. Trouble was, they had a range of about three, they handled 3-to-1 SWR. So, you know, they handled up to 150 ohms in the range. And then people started building external tuners like the LDGs and so forth, and they were about a 10-to-1 SWR ratio depending on the band and so forth. So, but they were great because they were, you know, they had latching relays, and you could operate them off of batteries and so forth. And then SGC is another company that we'll talk about them in a little bit. They have an external antenna coupler. Big difference between a coupler and an antenna tuning unit. A coupler has a much, much, much wider range in what it can handle. And then, of course, if you have lots of money, and that's a joke for Alan, but the antennas themselves, like the Step IR, adjust itself. I mean, it adjusts the length of the elements, and everything gets matched and everything. So you're not dealing with any kind of tuning circuit, but the antenna itself is getting everything to be spot on. So when you use this ATU, where should you put it? Well, if you want to minimize the loss, you're really going to put the antenna where the SWR is determined, right there. You want to put that box right here. Now, that's kind of difficult if this thing's hanging 70 feet in the air, but some people do that. But what if you can't do that? What if you can't put the coupler there? Well, what I recommend is that you read this book, the SGC Smart Tuners for Stealth Antennas. It's available online from the SGC. It's all about couplers, why they use them, where to put them in the antenna systems, and so forth. It's an excellent bit of free information. Of course, it's to sell their couplers, but that's okay. We'll take the free information. Another way you can do it is you can use the McCoy or the universal dipole. Lou McCoy wrote for QST and other magazines years and years ago. But it was just a doublet that was at the lowest frequency, and you had a feed point, you had open wire line. Well, this is 450 ohm line, but maybe back then, let me show you. Maybe they used open wire line with insulators about this wide, and then they had multiple of these, and the wires would run down as an open wire situation. Very, 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 very low loss. Compares.
Ladder
line compared to this. Yeah, ladder line, open wire line. This is window line, because guess what? It has windows. It has nothing to do with Redmond, Washington. So, yeah. Anyway, but what on this dipole, the antenna stays put, the matching network is here. And the reason they put it here is because this line is very, very, very low loss. Even at high standing wave ratios, it's very low loss. So most of the power from the transceiver does get into the antenna. So we had these diagrams before. Let's look at them here. When you have a high standing wave ratio, you've got your forward power to the antenna, and most of the power goes back to the transmitter. And if you've got nothing in there, the transmitter will reduce power because the SWR is high. Okay, but then we bring out an ATU. We bring out this box right here, or the LDG or something, and we put it in line. Well, the ATU matches this 50 ohm line out of the transmitter. It matches it to whatever the impedance is seen here at this part of the feed point, because you know you've got this reflected power. So you have low loss between the transmitter and the ATU, but here you still have that high loss, but it's only on that part. If you moved the ATU to the antenna, you wouldn't have any of that reflected power. But it's right there. So what happens here on the line is that, and I'm going to show you an example of this, or tell you where to go see an example of this. Because of wave mechanics, because of the confluence of forward and reflected waves, and the impedances in the ATU, all of this is combined and causes something to happen that a lot of people don't believe. I didn't believe it until I researched it. But the forward power goes to the antenna. Some gets radiated. The reflected power, because of the mismatch, goes back to the antenna tuning unit. And that power is re-reflected and added to the forward power coming this way because of all this wave mechanics. And Walt Maxwell wrote a whole book about that situation. He wrote a series that's also on that sheet. Also on that sheet is this video. And Pete, where's Pete? Pete here. Oh, there's Pete. Pete can attest to this. What is this? Is this minute 41? Is it 40? This is available on Ham Radio Now. It used to be a DVD, but now he released it. You just go to Ham Radio Now, number 199, Standing Up for Standing Waves, and watch this. It's a demonstration of what I call them lecher wires, because you can actually see the voltages and the currents as they're measured and indicated by these lights. But having all that reflected power being added to the forward power is that light right there. It's brighter than the forward power coming from the transmitter, which shows you that that energy is re-reflected out. So it's just like that other video I was talking about, the AT&T video. This is dynamite. I mean, this nailed it for me when Pete says, minute 41. And I watched minute 41. I went, yep, that's it. I'm done. Now I know. You know, great stuff. So when you're measuring SWR, you know, you got to remember what it's trying to tell you. And you have published specifications on the coax to figure out, you know, using TL details and so forth. And use those TL details is free. And use those free details and watch these videos and get that information so you know a little bit more about your antenna. Use the appropriate coax for the situation. Sometimes you can use smaller coax. If you're running a lot of power, you use the larger coax. Use the best you can afford. And again, the length of the coax is from the antenna to the transmitter. No more, no more, no less.
Recommended.
Yeah, see? You get the prize. You noticed. Sir.
The previous video on this list, the one with the light bulbs, is that on this list?
Yes. It's called the second one, Standing. Yeah. That is really good. You'll really like that, Tom. Okay. We need to shut this down here pretty quick. But anyway, there are a couple of things I want to, I've heard people say, you know, that the definitions of things. A load is something that absorbs power. An antenna is the load. Loaded in the antenna world means that something has extra capacitance, extra inductance. It's loaded. It's causing the electrical length of that antenna to be more or less. If you put in a coil to load it, you're going to generate electrical length. But if you're going to put a capacitive hat at the end or in the middle, if your antenna is too long, you can add capacitive reactants. It's going to shorten it. So loaded means just that, adding capacitive or inductive reactants. A loading coil is this. It's the lump value of inductance. It's used to extend electrical length without adding any physical length. So if you need to have a shorter antenna, make the antenna short, but put in loading coils. And a trap. A trap is something like this. This is off a TA-33. We discovered it wasn't, but this is an identical thing. But it's a coil, and then this housing makes up a capacitor. It's a parallel resonant circuit, resonant at a certain frequency. And if the feed point's here and the charge is coming here at, say, 28 megahertz, this trap stops that from going all down there and causes it to head back to the feed point. That's what a trap is. It traps RF. It stops RF. So when somebody says, oh, I got coils on my Yagi, my TA-33, yeah, there's coils, but it really is a trap. So it's kind of semantics, but when you're explaining something to somebody, you need to understand what's going on. All right. Very quickly on verticals, that's another antenna system. You can use a quarter wavelength vertical. You can load it with a loading coil to make it shorter than it really is. You can put top hats on it, which are capacitive. They're just lengths of wire or lengths of rod. You put radial systems in there. People say, well, they're good DX antennas. They're easily fed. They radiate equally in all directions. There's no directionality to a vertical unless you use two or three or four of them. So Well, it all depends what you're trying to do. Anyway, they're simple to construct. They're just poles, you know, stick them in the ground and insulate them. They're not space saving. People say, oh, put up a vertical. I don't have room for an antenna. Well, with a horizontal antenna, you've got to have two trees or something supported. With a vertical, underneath that vertical, you've got to have a field of radials in order for it to work really well. And they're a little bit more susceptible to noise and so forth. But they do give a nice pattern, low angle of radiation and so forth. So that's good. That's another antenna that the neophyte can experiment with, put in his backyard, and she can measure whatever she wants to measure right there on the ground. It's pretty cool. But in order for them to operate efficiently, you've got to have those radials and so forth. So that's something you need to go for. There's been articles. That's the nice thing about ham radio. We can go to QST and look at those antennas and look at those articles back. This is 1976. I mean, I know that's not a long time ago, but that's when I was first getting into ham radio and so forth. Another one, Rudy Severns in 2010 wrote this. That's in March QST 2010. That is an excellent series on radials and what's required. So. What? What is this not? That? Okay, last thing. Let's talk about multibanding. Okay, we have this antenna up here. We put it up for 10 meters or 40 meters or 80 meters, and you go, okay, I'm getting tired of working 40 meters. I want to work something else. So what do I need to do to this particular antenna that's simple and enables me to get on a different band when it's resonant or matched and low loss, low standing wave ratio, everything we've been talking about? So you can use it on an ARD harmonic, you can use parallel wires, you can use traps, use an ATU like the McCoy doublet we showed, SGC antenna coupler, or the TTFD. Well, we'll go through each one of these. If you have a 40 meter dipole and you look at the standing wave of current on there, which is in blue, and you go to the odd harmonic, which is 15 meters, you go from 7 megahertz to 21. 21 is 3 times 7, so you get 3 half waves on 15 meters on the same wire. Well, if you look where it's fed, it's also fed at a high current point, just like the 40 meter. So it's been well-known fact that a 40 meter dipole will work well in a coaxial fed system on 15 meters. So that's a good way. Put up a 40 meter dipole, you get 15. Right off the bat. You can use parallel wires. It doesn't have to be 3 extra wires. It can just be 1. This could be 40 meters or 80 meters. This could be 20, 15, 10. Just string parallel wires fed from the same feed point. The system figures out which is the lowest resistance and what's the best match and puts more power into each of those wires. You can use a trap dipole. Put up a dipole and then put traps. And traps, you're looking at that trap, but this is a trap that's used for a wire dipole, something like that. And these are Unadilla, and you can buy these online. You have to buy 2, 1 for each side, of course. You can wind your own. Some of them, they use coax and so forth, so that's pretty easy to do. Okay, again, the universal doublet from that McCoy came up with. And I just say it's a McCoy dipole because he named it years ago, but everybody called it a open wire fed doublet. And that will operate on any frequency as long as that match box has a wide enough range to match to the transceiver to keep that 100 watts pumping out. Everything's pretty low loss because it's open wire line. W5TOM has this on his website. He's using one of those SGC couplers at the base of this 26-foot whip plus a little bit. You have to go online to see all that, but W5TOM.com, that's one of a good example that he's provided. There's other things that Tom has on that website, antenna-wise and otherwise. Here's the SGC tuner that he uses, the SGC 230, and that's sitting at the base of that vertical. And just one other way to do multibanding. How do you get multi-banding? There's an antenna called the TTFD, tilted terminated folded dipole. It was built in 1946. It was patented by B&W. They put it up. It's a very, very wide band dipole. Depending on the length, it'll go from 2 megahertz to 30. Gives a very low standing wave ratio because of the transformers and impedance transformers that are in it and everything. It's not as efficient as a dipole, but if a dipole can only be used on one band and this can be used on every ham band, there's an advantage there. It may be 5 to 6 dB down on some bands, but that's one S unit. You know, I mean, you want to put out as much power as you can, but it's an easy way to do that. Now, go ahead. Yep, until countrymen, the Navy guys, stole it from and put it into the ham radio books. But there's a fella in the club, I think he's a club member, anyway, Bill N4HPG, that's building these now, or trying to build these now, a very, very high power version. And he's done experimentations with it and everything. And he kind of got my interest up on this. But there's lots of articles online. But it's just another way to do multiband. Yay, thank you, because it's over. All right, I want to talk a little bit about this, the handout. Information is really the key. There are some really great books out there, and it's well worth the investment. One is Low Band DXing by John Davaldier. He's an ON4UN. He's Belgian? Yeah. Anyway, this is like the fifth version. You can actually find one of the versions online for free if you Google it. But the first two chapters, it's not about low band DXing. It's all about antennas. And let me just show you. Well, this one's not divided like the one I have. But this, hang on. Let me just show you something. Yeah, there it is. That'll work. The fourth version? Yeah. Look at this. This thin portion is operations of low band DXing. This is antennas. You know, it's very empirical. It's very hands-on stuff. Any of the Bill Orr books, the Cubicle Quad, the Beam Antenna books, these are older books. But you know, the physics is all the same. At the Ham Fest, if you see one of these laying around, you won't see the 1939 versions, but you'll see the 1974. All this information is valid today. Nothing's changed. So, you know, and you can pick these up for $2 and $3. Instead of buying a new one, that's $49, you know. If you like verticals, Paul Lee wrote in 73 magazine, he wrote a 12 series article on verticals, but it's now in a book. But you can get that. Another one is the Antenna Compendium from the ARRL. There's 8 of them now, and those are quite good. You can pick those up. This says $25 on it because I bought it new, but you can pick those up for $10, $15 a piece. One recent author that's come out is Joel Hallis, and he wrote this guide to antenna tuners, but he writes a whole bunch of stuff in QST itself. Anything he writes is quite good. It's all about the stuff about standing waves and reflected waves and antenna tuning units and what they do online. He explains the mechanics of it. So these are all in that the handout. One more important thing is I want to say that QST's online. If you belong to ARRL, you can get any article in QST from 1915. It's great. PDFs, beautiful. If you're looking at CQ, Ham Radio, or 73 magazine, which have hundreds and hundreds of articles, if you go to eBay and you can buy those DVDs on eBay, you can get all 243 issues of Ham Radio on a DVD for $12. You know, some guy in Canada. That's all right. But you can also do CQ and 73. So You know, information is the key. So.
W4RNL is the
expensive. But now you got that. That's LB CBIC. CBIC did hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of modeling and fact finding. It's really good stuff. But now it's behind a $20 fee.
Yeah, he died.
Yeah, but he died. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the Antennas people got it. So, anyway, let's finish this up. So, understanding that our antennas and transmission lines make up a system, and understanding each part of that system is most important in order that you place yourself within the cone of satisfaction. And that's all I have for the neophytes. I hope you enjoyed it. Hope you got some good information out of it. You know, for you new guys and even your old guys, if you've got questions or anything, let me know. If you're looking for an Elmer, I'll just give you Tom's address.